Welcome everyone to week two of Social Entrepreneurship. Thanks everybody for coming in this evening. The focus on tonight's class is going to be on idea generation. So good job everyone for completing the first assignment and coming up with 10 ideas and putting them in the spreadsheet. What we're going to do tonight, I'll go over the agenda for you, is review the readings on idea generation and note-taking and talk through some of the steps that go into how to be an idea machine. We're going to have a really fun 15 minutes or so where we, as a class, discuss some of the ideas that we came up with as well as what our other classmates came up with. Try to look at some patterns or themes we saw there, and then actually start to put some of those ideas together. I've got one example I'll share with you later when we get to it. But that's going to be a big part of class today, is thinking through the process in which everyone came up with these ideas, and then also being creative in how we can combine them into new ideas and potentially maybe business ideas, revenue-generating activities, things like that. And then after that, we've got a little interlude into picking a few of the ideas, and we're actually going to come up with a list of what are the first steps. So we had an idea. This is great. People have ideas all the time. What's one small, tiny, micro step that we can do to get a little bit more progress or momentum or move forward with actually implementing or executing or testing an idea? And then we're going to round out class with some Questlove lessons learned. You guys know Questlove from the Roots? Cool. So I'm listening to his audiobook, Creative Quest, and he dropped some wisdom on me this week that I'm going to share with you. And then we're going to talk about next week's class and shifting into sales, which will be a lot of fun. Before I go on, does anybody have any questions? Awesome. So let's talk for a few minutes here about the readings. There was one from James Altucher on how to become an idea machine. Curious, what did you all learn from the reading and from coming up with some of your own ideas? That's great, and a great segue to what the next slide is. Good job. What else did we learn about idea generation?
Perfectionism is the enemy of idea generation. And I noticed that when I was trying to come up with ideas. I was actually with Nick, and I had to come up with like maybe 5 and like 10, 15 minutes. And he was like, you're just trying to be perfect. So.
That's good. And did you guys, especially in high school, too, like, have to be perfect on a lot of things and have to know everything and get everything exactly right? Well, one of the things I'm hoping you take away from this class is that's not actually how the real world works. You don't have to be perfect. Oftentimes, good, if something is like 80% done, that's good enough. Ship it, get it out the door. Don't spend an extra 5 or 10 hours polishing every little thing to make it perfect when you could go on to another project, another task. There are certain standards you want to meet. You don't want it to be a piece of trash, but once it's good enough, I think that's a great time to move on. What else did you learn?
Tim? After 2 weeks, the idea muscle atrophies. I thought it was like a good metaphor, although it may be literal. But.
Nice. And with that in mind, be careful. We have 2 weeks off where we don't have class, and I want to make sure the muscle doesn't atrophy too much over spring break.
If you're struggling to come up with 10 ideas, you should push yourself to come up with 20.
Yeah. That's a great mindset to have. Hey, if this is that hard, how do I do twice as much? And how do I do so much more where it's not, oh my God, I can't come up with one more idea. Awesome.
I like the idea of not being selfish with your ideas, and that like the idea is only like 10% and the work blood, sweat, and tears you put in. It's like the businesses that are iconic now.
Fantastic, and that's going to be a theme of this course too, especially because you guys are going to get to see everyone else's ideas. You know, that's by design, and one of the questions, you know, did you read, let me ask, with a show of hands, who read their classmates' ideas this week? Cool, that's good. And I encourage you to do that every week, and not just what are people's new ideas this week, are there past ideas that I can build on, can I add another layer, a new element? And something we talked about in week one was feeling like an artist, and taking, you know, somebody's nose and somebody else's cheekbones, someone else's hair and some other background, somebody else's outfit, you put them all together, that's a unique creative work of art. And I think you'll see as we go through this exercise each week, there are elements that might be interesting that you combine in a new way that you have definitely never thought of before, and perhaps nobody has ever thought of before, which will lead to a great question you can ask yourselves of, why hasn't this been done before? And when you think through some of these ideas, like what have been the previous barriers to entry, the things preventing other people from creating these ideas or executing them, and has something changed in technology or society or the access to resources or the access to funding, where you can now do things that 5, 10, 20, 40, 100 years ago weren't even imaginable. So a little technological example, like in the 1990s, if you were building a tech startup, you had to spend millions of dollars buying servers, like physical giant servers way bigger than this room, stack them all up to host whatever your product or service was on the internet. In 2019, you go on Amazon Web Services and you give them, you know, a little bit of money and they host them in the cloud, as many as you want, as big as you want. You don't need to have physical real estate to host the servers, you don't need to buy the physical servers, you don't need to have a technical person who understands how to connect them all, which is part of what's made today's like app economy so vibrant, is that there are so many fewer barriers to creating something and launching it out there. And that also is true with the different platforms for creating technology today. So you have, obviously, iPhone apps, Android apps, even like Facebook apps, that there are these toolkits that developers can use and build on that are platforms for lots of people to create things. And we'll talk about a little later in the semester how you think of creating a platform as a service versus just the actual service. So the next question I have for you all, I want to tap into the emotional side a little bit. How did you feel when you were coming up with ideas? Like you mentioned you thought a little bit like a roadblock when you got to 5 ideas, but what were some of the other feelings, beginning, middle, and end of the process?
I feel like I would just come up with something and write it down, and then like right at the end of writing it down, I'd be like, how could this ever like make sense? Or how could this ever like actually be viable?
Alright, so
I guess that's the point.
Yeah.
I think I was like looking around like a lot of my environment, like what like could like help like my life be like more convenient. So I think it made me more self aware of like my surroundings.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. We'll build on that in the next question.
I didn't really like my first couple ideas, and then I got to my 9th idea, and I was like, oh my god, this is really good, I actually really like this. And I realized like my first 8 ideas were either things like I wasn't excited about, or like maybe are already done, but like my 9th idea, it like felt really cool. I was like, oh, I can reach right it more.
That's awesome.
When I was sitting and writing them down, I had this like one done, and then I realized I need more and more, it was hard to generate them, and when I was looking back and thinking, should I actually have to have like a pen or like write down an iPhone, like in my phone? Because when I walk around and I see a problem, I usually go, oh, I could do that. But then you never remember those. So it's like, I was thinking of I hate writing, so probably still using the phone for that. But definitely writing it down, and then it's going to decrease the time I spend. Okay, that sounds bad, but.
That's the whole point, though. One of the things, once you start flexing this muscle every day, you can just be walking across campus, see a problem, take a quick note, and boom, there's one of your 10 ideas. So it also doesn't have to be you sit there and in one session come up with 10 ideas. You just kind of pull a couple a day and start to think that way.
I think at the beginning I was definitely being too practical with it. I was having fun with it, you know, like after every reading, I was talking about how an idea can be something other than like an invention or like a new app or something. And that's definitely what I was thinking along the lines, like while I was doing the, like, because I did do it in like a 10-minute sitting, 15-minute sitting,
yeah.
Just trying to get it all out. And I think that's wrong, looking in hindsight.
I don't think it's wrong. I think there's a lot of different ways
yeah.
of doing it, and you'll experiment each week with a different process.
Okay. I was kind of, at first when I sat down, like not a lot was coming to my head, but then I reflected back on the article, the Idea Machine article, and how the writer in there said how before he like does his 10 daily ideas, he really reads first, so I tried that. And I think that just helped me, like, when you have to, like, sit down and, like, think of the dream and to be, like, come up with an idea, like, that can be really daunting, but, like, breaking it down, reading something, kind of having that in the back of my mind helped me come back and, like, write ideas.
Awesome. I love that. And I definitely think reading beforehand helps you come up with ideas, as well as maybe being in a unique setting or you could be in your dorm room, the same thing you're always looking at, but pulling on what are things in your environment, and especially what are problems you encounter or issues, challenges in a daily routine that you experience, perhaps with lots of people like you. That's a great way to think through what are problems you want to solve. Next question, what are some of the kind of objects, thoughts, memories, people, places, things that helped you to spark ideas? You mentioned looking at your environment, but what are some of the perhaps physical things or memories that you guys kind of leveraged for the ideas? Brendan?
I thought of a few movies that I liked and I kind of drew ideas.
You like Star Wars, maybe?
Yeah.
I like that. Yeah, if we got an actual lightsaber, I think that would make this class a success. Tim?
I like looked to my right and I saw like a thermostat thing, and then I thought of like maybe plugging something in your phone and it can take like temperature, like humidity, and like barometric pressure, like all like in real time in your environment. I don't know if it's possible, but like
I think it's probably definitely possible. And fun fact, my brother owns a house and his furnace broke last week. Believe it or not, middle of January, not a good time for the furnace to break. 48 hours of freezing cold later, he got a brand new furnace, and now he has an app on his phone that tells him most of that information for his house. So it's not plugged into the phone, but he has a central thermostat and can be at work and change the temperature. So part of what coming up with these ideas is connecting it to experiences or stories you have in real life, and seeing how you might be able to weave things together. And if you know you can get that data on an app from like a central thermostat, I guarantee there's a way to plug something into the bottom of an iPhone and test that right here. So then it's kind of integrating two parts together, making sure that they talk. Just something to think through, what are the kind of the next steps for things. And then last question before we keep going, what are a few benefits of note-taking? The second article was all about note-taking and kind of writing down ideas as you're going. Can anyone remember or think of any benefits of taking notes? Computer science standpoint, it's one less thing you need to hold in your short-term memory. It's written down in the notebook. I know it's there. I don't have to remember that Questlove said be receptive, because I wrote it down, and when I was working on slides, here you go. That's a great one. One other benefit of note-taking?
Kind of on the same note, but you become a better listener, more like efficient.
Yeah. Pro tip, almost everybody will love it and be very grateful if they're talking and you say, oh, do you mind if I take a note? That's really what I thought, what you said was important or something I want to remember, or I laughed at the joke. I found a nice little one sentence permission to borrow somebody's thing. Nick, I could just say, oh, do you mind if I borrow that bit of brilliance? You know, I'm brilliant, you think I'm brilliant? Yeah, of course you can borrow that. That sounds awesome. And now you've got permission to feel like an artist and use that somewhere. Bailey, great job foreshadowing the next slide. I'll give you a star next to your name for the day. So good ideas come from bad ideas, and you need to have enough bad ideas to actually get to the good ones. Might be the ninth one, for example. I love Venn diagrams. If I had my way, and I think I will, we'll have a Venn diagram almost every week in class. There's all sorts of good ideas, and there's a lot of things that seem like a bad idea. And that little sliver in the middle is what Peter Thiel, who's a huge investor, an entrepreneur, said that's kind of the sweet spot where it seems like a bad idea, but I think we can actually turn it into a good idea. This usually happens when there's a giant market opportunity, if millions of people have a problem, if there's a new technology or something that just came out that you're kind of on the forefront. What seemed like a terrible idea at first was having strangers come and stay at your house when you're not there. Yet that's Airbnb, which is now like a $1 billion business in the hospitality industry, yet owns no real estate. So great minds discuss ideas, average minds discuss events, small minds discuss people. And this works on three levels. At the lowest level, my advice to you is don't gossip. Don't gossip at school, when you get to work, don't gossip with your family members, with your friends from home. Gossiping, talking about other people, whether there's a positive or negative sentiment is usually not a good idea, because it usually at some point has a negative dip. And I found it's a great rule of thumb to not say anything about someone when they're not in the room that you wouldn't feel comfortable saying to them if they were actually next to you or behind you. It's a great way to keep yourselves out of trouble, and it's also a good way to identify negative people in your life that maybe you want to put a little bit of distance in. If there's a friend or acquaintance, somebody, every time you talk to them, they want to talk shit about three other people or the other people at the party or your other friends from home, and they're just constantly pouring out this negative energy, I would encourage you to think about that relationship, and is that the energy that you want to be surrounding yourself by, knowing that we are tend to be the average of the five people we spend the most time with. So if you cut out some negative people, bring in some more positive people who are talking about events or even ideas on a more regular basis, I think a lot of good things can come from that. Average minds discuss events. That includes sports. I like sports. You can talk about sports a fair amount, but at the end of the day, it's an event. And it's not as high up or as kind of self-actualizing, as you, if you will, as ideas. And so one of the things I think is going to unfold over the course of the semester, as you all are coming up with ideas every week, you're going to start talking to people about these ideas. They're not just going to be in your head. Maybe you're talking to your roommate or friend from home or your parents. Hey, you know, check out this idea I came up with. They don't have to be good ideas, but by socializing them, by sharing them with other people, you're inviting feedback and recommendations on how to improve those ideas. Here's a snazzy picture of a brain store idea machine. We are currently in the first amass phase, where we're just trying to amass as many ideas as we possibly can. We're going to then discover and prepare some of them, and finally, towards the end of the semester, implement some of these ideas. And so we all read the article by James Altucher. The next four slides were created by his, like, 13-year-old daughter. I just want to put that in perspective, that anybody at any age can come up with ideas, where you write down 10 ideas a day. I've generously expanded it to a week for you all throughout the semester. Again, you're stretching that muscle. Execution is a subset, but you're not coming up with ideas to execute on all of them. You just want to get the ideas. And as you start getting ideas for other people, you can share them with other people. There's a fascinating thing that I've found. If I have a random good idea that might help somebody else in business or on a school project or even in their personal lives, to just share the idea with them. You know, write them a few sentences in an email. Hey, I was thinking of you. I know you've been struggling with something. Here's an idea I thought might help. Or even make a list of 10 ideas. You want to get a summer internship somewhere? Check out a company you're interested in. Make a list of 10 things they can do to either improve their website, their marketing, how they communicate, even ideas on how they could recruit on campus. Maybe you want to work in HR at some point. And give these ideas to businesses or people who work at companies. You'll get people's attention. And some may be really grateful, some may be like, what the hell is this? Some may not respond. But if you put enough of these ideas and list of ideas out in the universe, I think good things will happen over time. To Zach's point earlier, you don't want to be a perfectionist, you want to get the ideas out. And then we get to the fun part with idea sex. So we're going to dive into that tonight. And I mentioned sending the great ideas to people who can really benefit from them, and asking nothing for return. This ties in with a whole theme for the class on encouraging all of you to be givers. So Adam Grant is a professor at Wharton UPenn. He's got a great book and a TED Talk called Give and Take. And it's all about three types of people: givers, matchers, and takers. And he found in the book, and I found in my experience, that givers are the best kinds of people. And the more ideas you have, the more of an abundance mindset you have, the more you can give those ideas freely. And not be like, hey, I gotta get, you know, $100 for that idea. Or I want 10% royalties for every cat t-shirt you sell with my cat on or something. The more you give, the more the universe tends to help you out in other ways, especially if you can do something called a 5-minute favor. So if you can help someone and give them an idea and it takes you 5 minutes or less, just do it. And get in the habit of every day doing at least 1 5-minute favor. I think that's something that's at the core of social entrepreneurship. And all the amazing social entrepreneurs I know who've built great, mediocre, small, all shapes and sizes social enterprises are givers and are people who will definitely go out of their way to help other people and ask nothing in return. And it doesn't have to be, oh, now you better invest in my company. You know, it's about building relationships, adding value. And we'll talk a lot next week in the sales lesson about the mutual exchange of value. And nobody should feel like they got hoodwinked or you pulled a fast one on them when you did a deal, you sold them something. Like, they should genuinely be delighted with the value that they got from the interaction. And the more you met their needs, even their unrecognized needs, the more likely they are to be a brand evangelist or just tell somebody how great you are or how helpful you've been or to recommend you for a job or promotion or other opportunities that might come up. Lots of ideas. The good news is ideas only cost 5 cents. So for a buck, you can get 20 ideas. So everybody chipped in about 50 cents worth of ideas this week. All right, we're going to keep track of that over the course of the semester, because ideas need muscle. And you need to put some work into it and be willing to stretch them. You're probably going to want to look at the ones over your shoulder to be able to read what's on the screen. I try to take a screenshot of the list of ideas. And what we're going to do probably for the next 10 minutes or so is look at these lists aggregated together and try to come up with some themes or patterns or different ways that we can combine more than one of these ideas. So I'm going to talk for about another 30 seconds, let your brain digest some of these things, and look for ways to put them together. Some of the themes that I noticed included portability, food, earbuds or muffs, insurance policy for laptops. Maybe you could have an insurance policy for your earmuffs. Fun socks. There was some interest in a dating app for dogs or pets. If you change dating to breeding, it sounds a little bit more like maybe a business idea. You know, people will spend hundreds, thousands of dollars on fancy dog or horse breeds. They'll spend like hundreds of thousands of dollars on. A lot of integration of apps. There are some programs or services that either are for college students that we could do for other age groups, or maybe they exist for other age groups and would be great for college students. The hydration level tracking. I'll quote my good friend David Fitzpatrick that hydration is a process, it is not an event. So that's something as you track it, like having one sip of water, I'm not done hydrated. It's part of the process. About 2 minutes on another sip of water. All right, so understanding perhaps a way on your phone or even with a sensor like connected to some part of your body to track what your hydration levels are. Did you guys hear about the Leonsis Prize in the fall? The entrepreneurship competition. Leonsis family sponsored it. They had, I think, 8 finalists who presented. The woman who actually won the whole Leonsis Prize competition, Shivani, her business idea is a sensor, kind of like an earring up here that would track her oxygen levels in her blood. She's got a rare disease that she has a hard time breathing sometimes, has to bring like a machine with the nose tube to help her breathe. However, people with that condition, and it's a problem, a pain point she personally has, and I think millions of people who have this around the world, is that if you run out of oxygen and you pass out or something, it's kind of hard to tell your family members or call 911 or have somebody get alerted. So the sensor that would be connected to track your oxygen levels would be able to send a text message alert to loved ones and primary care doctors, potentially call 911 if it drops below a certain level. That's freaking sweet. And the Leonsis family, I think, gave her $50,000 to keep working on this and developing it. And that is very similar to a hydration tracking wearable device. So again, it's finding things that are similar. What's the different variable? How are they tangentially related? If Shivani builds this thing out and gets all this integration and then data goes into an app and it can be sent these different ways, all you have to do is have a different input that tracks hydration instead of oxygen, and the whole rest of the thing's built. So another fascinating thing, as you actually do build and execute on some of these ideas, you can be creating templates that you can use in the future to extend the idea or iterate on a different industry or location or service, knowing that, hey, I've got 60 to 80% of it already built. That's a lot easier than saying, I gotta code this thing from scratch, I'm super overwhelmed, maybe you have to outsource it and pay somebody to develop it. That could be $10,000 at some cost once, or you could build 5 different things on top of what it is somebody built you. And the last couple themes that I saw were warm hands and feet. All right. So I'm gonna pause there. What were some of the themes you guys saw across multiple ideas, not just yours, some of the other classmates? And if you wanna try creating a combo, like the one I have there at the bottom, which was combining, I think, 6 of them, I'd love to hear your thoughts on these ideas. Tim, what's one new idea you see?
Just like any of them?
Yeah.
Wall paint that is magnetic.
Cool. Does anybody have ideas for what types of magnets we could put on the wall if it was painted magnetically?
A TV.
There you go. That'll work. Put a mirror on the magnetic wall. Maybe you could put photos of people, family, friends on the magnetic wall.
Shelving.
Yeah, we could put shelving on it and maybe very,
What happens if you wear a watch and walk past the wall?
That's a good question. Maybe everybody has to wear plastic watches. Or maybe you could start a watch selling business because you started accumulating all these watches as people walked by. Tim, what you got?
You could put a household band-aid dispenser, which is one of the ideas.
Yep. Where in the house do most people get cut?
Kitchen.
Huh. So maybe you could put the band-aid dispenser in the kitchen? That might be putting a solution closer to where problems tend to occur. Try to get two or three more new ideas coming out of just looking at other ideas that we as a class have come up with this week.
I like the app that tracks your speech during the day and reports the use of similar words.
That's a good idea. Different risk reward. You get a small thing for doing, you get a big penalty for not doing it.
Yep.
Do you think different people might be motivated different ways there? So there's author Gretchen Rubin who has a book called The Four Tendencies. Basically, there's four ways that people are motivated, either intrinsically or extrinsically. The first way is what's called an upholder. And an upholder is someone who, if I tell you I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it. If I tell myself I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it. And I'm an upholder. I like making commitments to students or external people, and if I tell myself I'm going to take the trash out, I'm going to take the trash out. Great. The next type is a questioner. They don't give a damn what other people say. Whatever you tell them to do, they're going to say, why? Why did you do that? Like, why is this important? However, once they get the answer to the question, they do internally agree that, hey, this is important, this is something that needs to get done. Okay, they're going to do it. Great. The most common type of person is an obliger. An obliger is someone who is actually terrible at New Year's resolutions because they set them every year, but they don't set up an external accountability system. And so obligers really need their friend Susie, who says, hey, I'll meet you at Yates at 10 a.m. to work out on Saturday morning. But if Susie isn't going to Yates at 10 a.m., and I'm just supposed to go at 10 a.m. to the gym by myself, I'm not likely to go. And going to the gym is one example, but there's lots of different habits and things that people try to do. They really are not only, but are significantly more likely to do things if they have that external accountability buddy. And it's important to kind of understand what your primary tendencies are, and then you can design systems to support yourself. If you know you need a buddy to do some certain things, then make sure you have a friend who's going to go with you. Now the fourth type, this is the hardest type, is the rebel. If I tell the rebel to take out the trash, they're not going to do it. Even if the rebel looks at the trash and is like, oh, that has to go out, I'm not going to do it. I have no really good advice on how to deal with rebels. They're a pain in the ass. Most kids, for significant periods of their life, treat their parents like this. And the other fascinating thing I found is that these are tendencies. Nobody has like this personality type 24 hours a day. And as your energy level fluctuates throughout the day, you are, at certain times, much more likely to be an upholder or an obliger or a rebel based on the amount of sleep you got, based on where we are in the day. So one of the guys I met last week was Dan Pink with his book When. So in the morning, the first 4 to 6 hours is when we tend to be the most vigilant and can do focused work. And if you drop something, I'm going to pick it up because I'm ready to go. However, when we hit that trough, that like afternoon 2 or 3 post lunch, thinking about taking a nap, really unlikely I'm going to take the trash out then. It's not that important. And then as you get past dinner, you might, you know, ramp up again and have some more vigilance, some more intrinsic motivation and or extrinsic motivation to get things done. The other caveat I'll throw out there, when's the last time you ate? And when people get hangry, they don't want to do anything. And I'm sure you felt this, and I'm sure you've interacted with family or friends who, you give them a Snickers bar or a snack or something, they're back to life and they're great. But man, there's that period of time where they're really hard to deal with. So that's something to keep in mind with folks. Both what are their natural tendencies, and based on the time of the day and their energy levels, how likely are they to oblige or question or uphold or even be a rebel? And perhaps if you have things you really need to get done, not asking people when they're exhausted and haven't eaten to do them, maybe after a meal and a good night's sleep is a better time to proposition or ask people for it. So, right. Two things I want to get through on here. First, the combo that I came up with sounds awesome. These are multilingual x-ray glasses that connect you to a hologram so you can learn new languages by talking to somebody else who knows the language, and I'm able to record the video and probably put it on Snapchat because that's what the kids do these days, and probably also put it on YouTube. And both me, when I'm actually recording, and anybody who watches in the future can zoom in or zoom out. All right, these are sweet glasses, right? Super important problem and pain point. Which is interesting here is these glasses are trying to solve like 6 different people's problems and pain points. This may be kind of feature overload or too many things in one product that aren't actually meeting the needs of the original niche, which I think was somebody who wanted to learn the language. I had to guess the base of this. Like, I don't know that if I'm learning a language, I need a hologram or I need to zoom in on that hologram. Maybe I could turn the volume up. That might be more useful. Maybe having subtitles. Oh, that's a new idea. Put subtitles on the hologram. Thinking about the problem you're solving, the pain point that people are experiencing, and not trying to do it all at once, because I don't think the x-ray feature is really doing too much here for this consumer. And I want to jump down to... I had a second kind of screenshot of ideas we came up with. Helps if I do it on this slide, I bet. There we go. So one thing, Nick, I think it was your idea was like sleep glasses or glasses to wear before you're getting ready for bed. So I'm gonna highly promote Felix Gray digital eyewear. I wear these glasses every day. They have a blue light filter in them to actively block out blue light, which is the worst for your circadian rhythm and for keeping you up late at night. I would highly encourage you to not lay in bed and scroll through Instagram, ever. However, if you're going to do it, if you put on your Felix Gray glasses, it's slightly worse or slightly better for your brain because all the blue light isn't coming in. I'll also throw out there that if your brain is just looking at Instagram before bed, it sees all these different things and tries to put them together, that's not slowing down. You want your brain to slow down to not be thinking about all the things on your phone or stressed out about projects and stuff. So there's a little bit of digital minimalism or just not having it. However, anytime after 6 o'clock, if I'm in a lit room or I'm looking at a screen, I'll always have these glasses on because they help my eyes. It's good for your eye health. I also happen to be friends with the founder of the company, David Roger, who's a Venture for America fellow. I had a sunglass company for 6 years, so I know a thing or two about glasses and supply chain and some marketing strategies there. And so I definitely think there's a real problem and pain point that millions of Americans face, especially knowledge workers or people that stare at a computer for 8 to 10 hours a day. It hurts your eyes. So that's one thing that already exists. We also already have washer-dryer combos. Fun fact, I studied abroad in Cork, Ireland when I was a junior, and I lived with another guy from BC. We were pretty normal, that's great. Also had like a 27-year-old French guy who shared our apartment, and we had one washer-dryer combo for the three of us. And I don't know why, but it took him about 3 days to do each load of wash, and you couldn't even like put something else in the washer because he was then drying it, and he had a significant other, so there was like girl clothes in the thing. I didn't want to. So sometimes it's better to have both of them separated so you could at least start the next process. And somebody also had an idea for a wellness system builder. There's an app I'll recommend called Fabulous. It's free to download and it helps you get momentum to adopt new habits. And it starts very simple. The first habit is just to drink a glass of water first thing in the morning. And then I've been able to build on that with saying some affirmations, having a healthy breakfast, getting a workout in. You can do morning, evening, or morning, afternoon, and evening routines if you want. So that's something I want to share, that you know, as we come up with these ideas, I encourage you to think about, okay, what have I already seen that's similar? How can I take parts of one thing to add to the next? All right, so let's pick, let's say, three new ideas, and they could be ideas you came up with or ideas for your classmates, things we've talked about this week. And I want to identify as a group the one next step. So first of all, somebody throw out an idea. It can be anything. You don't have to come up with the next step if you come up with the idea.
A real lightsaber.
A real lightsaber. Awesome. All right, so what do we think could be, and there's no right or wrong answer, what could be a first step or next step for this?
Watch Star Wars.
Watch Star Wars. All right, which episode?
Star Wars episode 4.
Star Wars episode 4, all right, good. What's the next step after that, or another first step we could take?
See if there's a market for lightsabers.
All right, who do you think a market for lightsabers could be?
Star Wars.
So we've got Martians, the military, and people who like Star Wars. So maybe you try to talk to 5 or 10 of each of those folks. I guess it's an interesting question. What pain point does a lightsaber solve? What is the problem that needs solving that a lightsaber is like the thing for it?
Enemies.
Enemies, all right.
Cutting, opening cans.
Cutting, can opening, yeah.
Oh my god.
What'd you say?
I was thinking like creativity for kids.
Lightsabers for kids.
That's
a pain point. Maybe we could put like a safety or like training wheels on them so you don't chop the other kids in half. Maybe they start as just a hologram without the actual slicing. I'm just thinking of how we not decapitate children with their ideas. Alright. Cool, so that's one idea. Pretty much, yeah.
If you like cutting meat with a lightsaber, then it like cuts it while you cut it.
Ooh. Good.
Like, you know the open restaurants when they like toss it up and do something.
Yeah,
can you imagine this sous chef tossing it up and like doing this and then it's on the plate?
Oh. Whoa, that's pretty cool. Have you guys ever played?
And if it's hot too, it can be like cooked at the moment, you know?
Yeah.
Right? Because it's like hot, right? I assume.
Okay.
Raw meat,
so.
if you cut it,
yeah.
It's kind of going to be not medium, not well done, raw meat, but you know.
I like that. And you guys ever play Fruit Ninja? So it's basically that with a lightsaber. So my buddies and I, we do Secret Santa every Christmas. And a couple years ago, my buddy's got a machete, which was cool. And then my friend whose house had an unfinished basement, so we actually played Fruit Ninja in real life, which was fun. We were like one slice, then you save. However, we learned, you know, on the phone you can kind of zigzag and like do the double slice. But when you do that, you tend to slice through the wall, and that's usually when the game ends. So I wouldn't recommend Fruit Ninja in real life, but maybe with a lightsaber it could be safer. Have you guys played Guitar Hero? Or you know that? Have you ever played Beat Saber?
Yes. Yes, I have. It is the most fun game on earth. It's ridiculous.
Mara, tell the class what it is.
Okay, so you have to have like a VR headset, so it's a VR game. And it's like, if you guys remember like Just Dance, so you have like movie to do. And basically there's like these blocks that come at you and the remotes you have in your hand are like lightsabers and you have to smash the blocks. Oh my god, it's so fun. Cascada, every time he touches my favorite one.
Love it. So it's literally Guitar Hero plus lightsabers plus virtual reality. They've got a bunch of their own songs.
Oh, it's so
and like
fun.
Users have generated, created any song they can basically put, you know, and they have arrows too of like what direction you gotta slash.
Yeah, you
can
like go down and like slice sideways.
So there you go. We've got some momentum on the lightsaber. Maybe it happens in virtual reality with a good soundtrack before it happens at the Mongolian Grill, but we'll see. Awesome. So Questlove said, I want to tell people what to do. I want to tell them what they can do. And that is definitely, I think, one of my hopes for this class, is a lot of open-ended assignments and idea generation and being divergent, so you can start to think and look at problems with a new lens, and understand what are things that you can do, both in this class this semester, throughout college, and certainly throughout your career and life, as you're going to encounter lots of different problems and challenges at different times. So Questlove also dropped some real wisdom on me today and said, you need to be receptive to new ideas. And this jumped out to me for a few reasons. One pattern that I matched it to is jumping back to Adam Grant's book, Give and Take, about being a giver. Some people who are givers will burn out. They give and they give and they give and they give and they give. And they forget to be receptive to asking for help. And so this, I think, is a really important concept for a well-balanced individual to be okay being a little vulnerable sometimes and be receptive to other people who want to help you. And just because, yeah, I could do it all on my own, I don't need anybody's help, and I'm going to take on the world. Yeah, man. Everybody who's made a big impact in this world has done it with other people. There is no single one-minded genius who just solved all these things by themselves. Zuckerberg has like 10,000 employees now, okay? Elon Musk probably has 20,000 employees with all the companies he's involved in. And as you're coming up with these ideas and starting to move them forward, I want you to be open to bringing other people in and to be receptive to what their ideas are. And their ideas may very often be partially or completely different than what your ideas are, and that's often a good thing. I'll share early in my career, I was running the sunglass company, and I played a lot of Frisbee, I coached a lot of Frisbee, and I looked around my company, and like, everybody working for Waveborn was Frisbee dudes. And I, looking back now, understand that there wasn't a lot of diversity in the team, and there also wasn't a lot of new original ideas and thoughts. We all kind of thought the same way, we had a similar upbringing. Most of us were, you know, white guys in our early 20s. I have found, as I've worked at Halcyon for a few years and been involved with lots of different organizations, that it's ideal to have diversity in all areas except for values. As long as your values are aligned, whatever your background is, your origin story, your major, the classes you've taken, the types of food you like to eat or are allergic to eating, where you go on vacation, what your parents do, how many siblings you have, where you fall in the sibling hierarchy definitely affects your personality, I've learned. And so being receptive and open and inclusive to bringing in lots of other people who can introduce you to some amazing things. And I'll connect that to one of the companies at Halcyon, it's called Equal Reality, and they actually do virtual reality diversity and inclusion training for companies and their employees. And the whole reason that I know about Beat Saber and how awesome it is because we incubated a company for 5 months that does virtual reality, and they would host on Friday nights, we'd do wine and VR and play Beat Saber, and it's like the coolest thing ever. And I've learned so much from, you know, this team of entrepreneurs, and so by surrounding yourself with other smart people who are doing different and unique things that are either tangentially near what you're working on or what you want to get really good at, or way out here in left field, you know, there is a lot of value in having those nearby and being able to bounce ideas off of people who aren't going to be looking at them the exact same way you are. And so what Questlove said after he dropped the knowledge about being receptive, when you hear new ideas, whether it's in a class or reading a book, it's probably a great thing to do as you work on your book report this whole semester. When you read something new, summarize what you're learning and isolate what your insight is. Sometimes it's verbatim what they said in a sentence or a paragraph. Sometimes you're summarizing a whole chapter in like 5 words. And so I'm reading this book right now, Wisdom at Work. You can kind of see that the majority of these pages have different things underlined. And this is, at this stage, how I read books that are interesting to me. I star things. You know, your title makes you a manager, your people make you a leader. It's a pretty great quote. A great question to ask employees, how can I support you to do the best work of your life here? Okay. So as you are reading and absorbing new knowledge, summarize what it is, identify your insights, and then turn those insights into a short one-sentence thesis or a hypothesis. Raise your hand if you know what a hypothesis is. Robert, what's a hypothesis?
An educated guess.
Yeah, and I'd even throw out there, it doesn't have to be educated. It's a guess. And so something really cool that you can start to try out as you're thinking about ideas is going up to someone and saying, hey, Angelique, I have a hypothesis that Georgetown students want cat t-shirts. Would you like a cat t-shirt?
No, I wouldn't. I'm allergic to cats.
You're allergic to cats? Well, that's good. There's a joke in here about selling you some, allergy medicine along with the t-shirt, but I don't think so. By going up to anyone and saying, I have a hypothesis that, you give them the freedom and the right to tell you you're wrong. And you don't say, I know for sure that this is absolutely true. No. I have a hypothesis that, lightsabers are going to be something black. I can't think of anything else. Brendan, what's your hypothesis about lightsabers? Share a hypothesis.
I don't know. I haven't really gone that far. Lightsabers are...
I have a hypothesis that...
I have a hypothesis that lightsabers are, I don't know, they're going to be like the new...
cooking utensil?
Yeah.
There you go. And now you can strike up a conversation about lightsabers used for cooking. Alright, so I encourage you, that little simple phrase, I have a hypothesis that allows you to kind of test them and talk to more people. And it's great when you find people that are maybe smarter or levels up or have more experience in certain fields. And you say, hey, I'm a beginner, I'm just learning this, I'm learning the ukulele. So like, I might have a hypothesis that it's impossible to hold the ukulele while standing up. And people will be like, well, it is a lot easier if you sit down, however you can do this like elbow crutch thing and kind of hold it, but I still have a hypothesis it's impossible to do standing up. So seeking out those opinions from other people can be very effective and useful. Show of hands, how many people had at least one new idea in class tonight? Great job, you already started your homework for next week. All right, we're not gonna dive as deep each week in what all the ideas are that people have come up with. Maybe we'll spend 2 to 3 minutes at the beginning of each class just having people shout out some of their favorite ideas that they came up or classmates came up with. Or I always think it's more fun when we make combos and have like a 7-layer dip of some new idea. I think that's something we'll do in the first 5 minutes each week. Jumping ahead to next week, we are going to focus on sales. Do you guys know your ABCs?
Always be closing.
Say it again?
Always be closing.
All right, always be closing. So one thing I've learned is that you can't close anything if you don't have a pen. So take one. Pass it around. Every good salesperson has a pen in their pocket at all times.
Yeah. Can we do names again?
I would love to do names again. You want to kick it off? And maybe we'll do that at the beginning of each class too, just so we remember people's names. I have a cheat sheet, but nobody else does, so it's a good question. So jumping forward to sales, these pens are important. I literally always have a pen in my pocket. On the other side, I've got my field notebooks. I uploaded a few Google Drive files today on sales. There is a book report that I did on the Closer Survival Guide, which takes a 300-page book and makes it like 9 pages. Just read the 9 pages. Whenever I can find a book summary or a book report that I've done throughout the semester, I do the clip notes. I also uploaded the full thing if you want to look at it or on your free time. I have a hypothesis. Planet would benefit from getting better at sales. Even the top salesmen and the top selling companies, they're not done learning, practicing that craft. And sales isn't a full-time job. It's something you do every single day in influencing people and getting them to help you in various ways. And getting your roommate to take the trash out, ideally when they're more of an upholder than when they're a rebel, we'll see. The second reading for next week is Anatomy of Sales Funnel. It's about a 14-page PDF. Do you guys know what a You guys know what, oh Jesus, you guys know what a funnel is? Kind of looks like a beer bong for sales. So we're going to go through how that process works for selling products and services, how you get people to kind of go further down that process, and the 14-page ebook breaks down how to make a landing page, what are all the steps of attracting people to it, getting their email address, proposing a solution for their needs, and then upselling, cross-selling, things like that. I'm going to do some YouTube research tonight or tomorrow and upload a few short clips from Glengarry Ross, which is where Always Be Closing comes from. Coffee is for closers. There's a great like 7-minute monologue. Basically just going to find badass monologues. If you've seen Boiler Room, there'll definitely be a couple clips from there. You're all 18, so it's okay if they curse in these clips. As I listened to Boiler Room in my head, I was like, oh. And I will try to maybe find full copies of the movies, or I'll let you on the internet or Netflix or however it is that you can stream video content watch some of these movies. I think they'll be very enjoyable. And then extra credit for next week. If you watched one of these full movies, I'll give you an extra credit point. Just shoot me a note and say, hey, I watched it. And one thing you learned or liked about it. The other extra credit that's available next week, next Wednesday at 7 o'clock, is the Rocket Pitch event. Did anybody throw their name in the hat to pitch there? One, two, awesome. If anybody goes to the event, you're both going to get 5% extra credit. And anybody who attends the event will get 2.5 points as well just for going. And you got to bring either a notebook or something to take notes on the people's pitches, partially on their ideas and partially on their pitching and presentation techniques and what do they do well, not well, where do they get laughs, what do you want to emulate in your presentations and what are things you want to avoid. And that wraps it up for this week. Thanks, everybody.
Where's your
On the 10 ideas per week sheet, there's an extra credit tab.
You're
or
allowed to
just put a 1 in anything you want.
Got it.
Thank you. Does anyone want a notebook? I have, 2, 3, 4, 5. He gets first pick. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Can I get you?
Yeah, I signed up first, but what do I know? Like, do I get in?
I think you'll find out.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay.
Well, so you want to think these notebooks are not here. I thought this was two things in my pocket. And then my next one is.